England is a wonderful country. It's steeped in heritage, and with over 2,000 years of recorded history, there's plenty to see and investigate. Trouble is, much of it's taken for granted, ignored, and overlooked. Parts of it may be crumbly and falling to bits, or barely visible, but it is ours to cherish. So, I'm on a mission to remind the world just how good it is before it's lost forever. Who am I? I'm the Bald Explorer. If you travel across the English countryside, whether by car, by train, or on foot, sooner or later there's one thing you'll come across. It's in the landscape, it's ubiquitous. In fact, the country wouldn't be the same without it. Sooner or later, you'll come across one of these. A rural parish church. Lovely, isn't it? And iconic. Quintessentially English, you might say, with its pointed spire, castellated bell tower, great eastern window, south porch, quaint lych gate, and well-kept graveyard, a place of peace and solitary contemplation. And you don't have to be religious to appreciate its architectural beauty and its historic importance.
But wouldn't it be awful if this idyll disappeared? In many parts of Britain, it already has. When a village declined due to lack of work or poor harvests, or it physically moved because of pestilence, you often find these stranded, deserted churches in the landscape.
In the early part of the 16th century, Henry VIII permitted a wanton act of vandalism and dissolved the monasteries.
These were fabulously impressive, immensely spectacular architectural gems of their time, and they were worth a fortune to the king. These monastic houses were scattered all over England and Wales. They were places of learning, of prayer, and of exceptional influence. They looked after the poor, and they gave the traveller a bed for the night.
Their scars still haunt the countryside some 500 years later.
So, by the flourish of a pen, these stunning and state-of-the-art buildings, the like of which had never been seen before, came unceremoniously tumbling down. Nothing quite like them would ever be built the same. Surely, it could never happen again. And yet, in not so dramatic a way, some of the children of those ancient houses are falling to bits in front of our very eyes, almost to the point that it becomes impossible to raise enough funds to save them.
With congregations shrinking, less of the population attending, and fewer coppers being donated, should we continue to fight for these churches, or wouldn't it be better to let them crumble gracefully away? All over Britain, rural parish churches are facing the problem of repairs, some more so than others.
Well, here's a sort of classic example, if you like, of a church that now is no longer in use and has been abandoned.
In this programme, I want to find out how likely we are to lose these ancient buildings and what they mean to the communities they stand in.
See, this is really interesting, stumbling across a find like this. It may be derelict, it may be disused, but actually, it's fascinating. You're out for a walk, and here you are, and you come across this mystery. And you want to know, and you're on the internet searching all about it, finding out its own unique story. Probably the brickwork must have come from local supplies, because how else would you get it here in the middle of nowhere? It's here as a reminder that if we don't look after some of our historic heritage, they can just crumble away and disappear. A tiny little church like this would have been visited by a local priest, and the headmaster of the Fittleworth School came along to assist as a lay reader. And it was really essentially set up for the charcoal burners and the farmers in the area, just small, local, rural people. This is St Nicholas, a typical rural parish church lying in the centre of the village of Itchingfield in West Sussex. The nearest commuter town is about 4 miles away, the historic market town of Horsham.
My name is John Gay. I am the rector of Itchingfield with Slinfold. Itchingfield's an interesting place because most parishes will have the parish church in the centre of the village. In rural communities. Here we're a little bit off centre from the main body of population. We've got a very dedicated congregation, but we're few in number. We really could do with more. Well, any church will tell you they could do with more, even if they've got 3,000 that come on a Sunday, they will tell you that they could do with more. One of the limitations that we have here at Itchingfield, which is not that unusual with rural parishes in general, is that we could really do with some good kitchen facilities and toilet facilities. If we did, then we would be able to do a lot of other things that we can't at the moment.
Built at the beginning of the 12th century, this church would have been at the centre of its rural community for at least 900 years. Of course, it's been renovated and extended many times over that period. A church of its age, like all buildings, would need plenty of loving care and attention to maintain it.
The problems we have here are problems that are quite widely found in rural churches. Churches like ours were built in a different time, and they were built with local materials and local labour. Today it's become much more complicated. Our particular problem with our church roof, which is not uncommon, is that we need to renew the lead in the valley gutter. Our problem is that because our church has a Horsham stone roof, we can't just take the bottom two sets of tiles off, do the lead work, and then put it all back. We actually have to take off the whole of the side of one part of the roof and most of the side of the other half, and then do the work, and then put it all back, which of course is a very big, costly business these days. Water isn't coming through at the moment, but we've been advised that the lead is sufficiently thin in places that if we don't get it done soon, water will come in, and then of course we'll have water damage with all the rest of the interior, and that would be it would be enormous, yes.
And of course, this isn't the only one facing these type of problems. This story is repeated up and down the UK. But with congregations of only 30-odd and the country slumped into austerity, what are the chances of them finding the necessary funding to keep St Nicholas and the others going?
We've been very fortunate. We've applied for various grants, particularly with English Heritage and the Sussex Historic Churches Trust, who've been very generous. It's been about 2 years in the doing. I think there's a certain resignation that these sorts of things are going to crop up every now and again. In 1985, the roof on the north side of the church was completely redone and relaid, and also the shingles on the tower were redone. So, yeah, every 20 years or so, something tends to crop up.
So realistically, without lottery funding, the roof won't get repaired. The church would probably close its doors and it may have to be sold off. But is that such a bad thing? I mean, after all, if a church can't pay its way in the world, shouldn't it be allowed to change its use or even crumble away?
I'm Kath Clark and I live in the village of Barnes Green. I think it's a tragedy really for the community, because although not everybody attends church, it is still there and it's still important in people's perception of a village. I come at least twice a week to check on the graves, or to bring flowers or plants, and just to make sure that everything is reasonably neat and tidy.
Let's look at it another way. Suppose we did abandon St Nicholas and many of the other churches in the rural landscape. What exactly would we be missing? Well, to answer that question, we need to go back in time.
Nine 900 years ago, Henchenfield, as it was known, was a forested area in the Rape of Bramber. A small part of the woodland still remains. However, as the community grew, more of the land was brought under the plough, and we find it surrounded by farmland today. It would appear that the church was built in 1125, not long after the Normans had arrived. It was then that England was divided into large swathes of land and given in trust to the loyal knights that had helped William to conquer and make extinct the Anglo-Saxon rule. In this part of Sussex, these land grabs were called rapes. So Itchingfield found itself within the Rape of Bramber.
There was a castle at Bramber. It was the centre of operations and where the administration was held. Parts of it are still standing. We think of Normans as invaders when, of course, they were conquerors. They didn't come here with thousands of their country folk to settle like the Saxons did. No, they wanted to dominate, rule, and, of course, make a profit. Their impressive castle, here on its raised mound, with its grand views, was a sign of Norman power and dominance.
Each rape was too large for one knight to maintain, so they were subdivided into manors and given to subordinates to manage. Because Itchingfield was just a farming community at the outer edges of the manor, it was probably left alone much of the time.
In that 900 years, much would have gone on at Itchingfield. People would have been baptised, married and buried here. Celebrations, festivals and community events would have centred around the church. Bear in mind that in the early days, although a humble stone building, it would have been the most substantial one in the village, rising high above everything else. These were simple country folk, mainly farmers and peasants, living in plain houses made of timber, all on one level and very primitive. Not only was the church the religious centre, but it was also the social point of the village. And it could have been used for a whole host of secular use, as well as worship. It was effectively the village hall of its day. It was open, and spacious, especially compared to the other buildings, and had very little in the way of furniture. Pews and seating didn't arrive until the 14th and 15th century, when sermons were a larger part of the service, and people naturally wanted to sit down. Always keen to find an income, the powers that be realised that these seats could be paid for. So, the more money you had, the closer to the front you got. And of course, the cheap seats were at the rear. But it wasn't until the summer of 1889 when pinned to this very door, there was a notice advising the parishioners that from then on in, all the seating was free.
A particular rarity is the survival of this charming priest house, set in the churchyard at Itchingfield.
Very unusual, very rare. Built probably as a little cottage, about 1500 or thereabouts. I'm Wendy Dawkins. I've been coming here to church since the mid-70s when I joined the choir. I'm church warden and sacristan. The uses of it are really quite a mystery, as they are for many, many old buildings. Not everything was all written down. People couldn't write very well. And its use for many years was thought to be for housing for a monk from Sale Priory that came down to take a service and collect tithes. Yeah. Although at the time that this was built, there would have been woodland the other side in the churchyard as it is now,
right.
Currently.
Yes.
So it would have looked like a cottage and probably had a little garden area. It still stands. It remains unmaintained, actually, because we have to focus our budget for the maintenance of the church.
Yes.
And so this has to stand on its own, and we hope we keep a close eye on it, and we hope that it will remain here. It's got a lovely inglenook fireplace here, and these two rooms, this lower room and the upper room, were built just after the main part of the priest house was built, for the purpose of almshouses, to house the very poor of the area. And before the advent of the poorhouse in Horsham.
The stairs is interesting, isn't it?
Yes.
The tiny little stairs.
A tiny little stairs that curls up. It's almost a circular staircase, but it's half circular. And it's all timbered like this, topped with the Horsham stone roof. As we enter the priest house in this end, you'll see it's really full of lots of goodies, because we're about to run a little a Gateway to Spring event in the church to raise some more money. But this, as you see, is the other end of the priest house, and this is where the minister or the monk would have come and stayed while he was performing his regular church services here in the church and collecting the tithes for the area, and it would just be used as a stopping point on his way round.
I'm Max Fisher. My main enthusiasm for the last 2.5 years has been to set up this tabletop shop. I will accept anything that I feel I can get rid of and make money out of. And as well as selling here, I can sell on eBay, through local auctions, any way that I've found that might be suitable for each of the different items. I'm just fundraising for the church. At the moment, the main project that we've all got our sort of hearts on is the structural side of it. Should we ever conquer that, then there would be things to look forward to in the future about building anything that was permissible in the toilet line, kitchen line, practical things like that. Sort of moving the church forward in time, really.
In the medieval period, tithes were collected. Now, that was 1/10 of your income from whatever source given to the church. In a rural place like Itchingfield, that may not have been hard cash. They perhaps offered fruit and veg and services rendered. It all went to help maintain the fabric of the church. It helped keep the vicar, the rector, and the curate.
In those days, carpenters and blacksmiths were usually on hand to help repair and fix the church.
Christianity wasn't introduced into Britain until the Roman occupation, But it wasn't until the 7th century, when the Anglo-Saxons converted to Catholicism, that things really took off. And so began to emerge the new churches. Many of these were constructed on pagan ritual sites and places of sacrifice. These new churches were often wooden in nature, making use of the abundant forests. Oak was the preferred building material, but it was often called the British weed because it was everywhere. But those canny Saxons, they weren't too bad with a bag of stones either.
This is Botolf's church, built originally around the 10th century, making it pre-conquest. It's just a mile or so down the road from Bramber Castle that we saw earlier. I'm pleased to say that it's fared a lot better than the Norman stronghold.
And like all churches, of course, it's had its repairs, its additions, and strangely enough, in this case, a subtraction, as you can see here. These arches, as we'll see on the inside, is a sure indication that there was an extension on the north face of the church, built in the 13th century, an aisle. Well, in 1776, it was reported to be in a bad condition, so it was subsequently filled back in, finished and completed by at least 1830. But by then, the village of Botolf had dwindled into almost nothing. You can't really see it from here, but to the east is the River Ader. Now, when Botolf's was constructed, the river was much wider, like a wild marsh, and it was from that marsh that salt was extracted.
It was thought that there was a crossing here, as the area was for a time known as Old Bridge, and Botolf was the patron saint of travellers. It's been a long-standing convention that the church maintained local bridges.
Anyway, the sea is a couple of miles south, and the estuary here gradually started to recede, and the old saltworks industry died out, along with it the inhabitants. So the church was left alone. Let's go and have a look inside. Well, the first thing you notice about this church is its age. It is old. Yes, Saxon, but it's got later Norman additions. It has a simple nave and chancel, and the tower was added sometime in the 14th century. And here are the pillars and the arches, which show quite clearly where the three bay aisle would have been before it was filled in. The chancel arch is narrow, classically Saxon, and above we can clearly see painted on the wall murals. Most people in the Middle Ages through to the medieval period were illiterate, so stories and religious instruction was best conveyed by picture. So the Saxons, they weren't bad masons. I suppose they'd only just got going with using stone as a building material when the Normans arrived. And for the conquerors, once they had subdued the country, stone was the choice building material. So, they replaced their forts and their castles, which had been hastily erected in timber, with strong, superior stone. And after that, they did the same with churches.
The late 14th and early 15th century saw the construction of the West Tower, housing the belfry and providing a western entrance. And there's a delightful one at Itchingfield.
Look, two. Treble's going. She's gone. Through the vestry. The bells were originally rung here until the 1950s, and then they decided to put them up there. So if we go up this narrow staircase, and then under this little arch, it's all made of wood. And so in the dry weather, when the beams all shrink a little bit, you can feel the tower moving when we ring the bells. I mean, it's perfectly safe, but you just feel the slight movement.
The main maintenance, I suppose, is the ropes, which wear, and the mechanics of the bells, the bearings and that sort of thing. The frame has to be tightened up. In a place like this at Itchingfield, this is rather a unique tower because it's constructed of oak beams from the ground upwards. The corner posts are tree trunks, virtually. And originally it was independent from the church, although it's been latched onto it for stability purposes now.
If you didn't have bell ringing, would it be missed?
I think so, yes.
I think there's no doubt that that is the case. Often we go to a tower where perhaps they haven't got any ringers, and the local people say how nice it is to hear the bells because they miss them.
Is it an art that's disappearing?
Oh no, I don't believe it is.
No. There's plenty of young people coming.
We wouldn't say plenty. Recruitment is not easy these days. Because there's such a wide range of activities available for children and youth, and many of the youth don't like getting up early Sunday morning to ring the church bells, it has to be said.
It's a very English tradition. I believe there's no ringing like this on the continent. So if we lost bell ringing, it really would be, you know, one of the English traditions that's gone, and that would be really sad to lose that. And people enjoy ringing, even if they don't have any faith and come to church, they still enjoy ringing.
The Saxons were famed for their small, splayed windows. The Normans for their round arches, a style often called Romanesque because it harked back to classic Roman designs. They loved to decorate their entrances with elaborate carvings, which are easily recognisable from the chevron or regular zigzag shapes. As the Normans became anglicised, the now English architects developed new building methods, and the churches were transformed again. A new feature was the pointed arch, or lancet. Walls were thinner, and the buildings taller and more elegant. Flying buttresses were introduced to keep the walls in place. Spires sprouted, pointing to the heavens, and towers became pinnacled. It seemed as if nothing could stop this frenzied building craze. And then Henry VIII broke away from the Roman Catholic Church. The monasteries started to tumble. It's believed that about 700 buildings were affected by the dissolution. Henry's son, Edward VI, succeeded him, aged only 9 years. It was during his brief 6-year reign that he ensured that the new prayer book of 1552 introduced Protestantism up and down the country. Images, shrines, rood lofts, and statues of saints were removed or broken. Stained glass windows were smashed, wall paintings were whitewashed, and a new altar was swapped for the Holy Communion table.
What must that have been like for a parish like Itchingfield and all the others up and down the country? Surely it must have seemed bizarre and strange. A way of life that had been practiced for as long as anyone could remember, snuffed out almost overnight and the new order given. It must have been a bitter pill to swallow. And then, just as the labourers, the farmers and the peasants, not to mention the priests and vicars and curates, were getting used to the idea, up pops Mary, Bloody Mary as we know her, and reintroduced Catholicism.
And Mary ensured that all the screens, the images, the wall paintings and statues were all returned. After her, her half-sister, Elizabeth, acceded to the throne and promptly repudiated papal supremacy. England was once again a Protestant country.
And you can't help feeling sorry for all those carpenters, builders and artisans. I mean, they must have been scratching their head thinking, fixtures and fittings, in or out?
And we're only halfway through the history. But as you can appreciate, even these chocolate box type churches out here in the sticks are all part of the fabric of our national heritage. To lose them is to wipe away the story of thousands of people. Almost a century after the Reformation came the English Civil War, and many of the remaining, but by now disused and mostly inadequate castles, were quickly tarted up and reused as military strongholds, as were prominent manor houses, but also churches.
It's 1643. King Charles I is on the throne, but he's being challenged by Parliament about his divine rule. The English Civil War has been running for just over a year. Brother has been set against brother, royalist against parliamentarian, roundhead against cavalier. And in the medieval town of Alton in Hampshire, they're about to give blood.
I'm Julian Humphreys and I work for the Battlefields Trust, which is a UK charity which is dedicated to preserving and promoting the history of Britain's battlefields. Well, we're at the moment in the churchyard of St Lawrence Church in Alton in Hampshire.
Yes.
And the reason why we've come here actually is because it's the site of one of the most extraordinary little battles of the entire English Civil War.
Okay.
The reason why there was a battle here is the fact that at the end of 1643, the Royalists had done quite well. They'd advanced up through Cornwall and the West Country, and they'd sort of reached their high water mark. They'd been quite successful, but it had stopped in Hampshire to go into winter quarters, and part of that army was based here in Alton. Well, I guess that Alton was quite a cosy little spot for these Royalists, but actually it was a position of some danger, because only 10 miles up the road at Farnham, there was an entire roundhead army that was just waiting to pounce, and a very able general called William Waller. And Waller realised that the Royalists were rather dangerously split up, being quite a distance from each other in all these different towns. And he thought, actually, if I can get my army together and we can attack quickly, we might be able to pick off one of these garrisons before the rest of the Royalist army could get together again. Right, so the Royalists are in something of a predicament here. They're outnumbered, they're almost surrounded, so they have to react quickly. So what they decide to do is to send their cavalry out of the town and try and get reinforcements from the other Royalist positions, while the infantry will hold on as best as they can here in the town. Now, they are actually forced back. It's inevitable, really. They're outnumbered and the parliamentarians are about to work their way up the streets and across the fields of the town here. But there is a natural place where the Royalists can fall back to, and that, of course, is this churchyard. You've got a fairly solid wall which provides some cover, and you have to imagine, I suppose, that in December 43, all along this wall, where the tombstones now stand, you would have had Royalist musketeers leaning out here with their muskets, trying to pick off any parliamentarians as they came across the fields that were once here, or the steep roads leading up from the town itself. And of course, if they were driven back from the wall itself, they still had the church as a last resort in which to fall back into. So there's been fighting for quite a long time now, but the parliamentarians have worked their way around to this side, the south side of the church.
Okay.
So now they're attacking from a number of directions.
Yes, of course.
Now they can see muskets sort of poking out at them, but after a while, it all goes a bit quiet. And the parliamentarians think, well, have the Royalists run out of ammunition? Have they run away? We don't know. So they got a volunteer and he led a party of men forward to just really see what was going on. And so very cautiously, you know, he came into the churchyard and peered around to see what he could see. Well, he could see muskets lined up all along the churchyards here, but no men. The Royalists have scarpered, so This was their chance. So he turned round, summoning his chaps. They're not there. There's one guy. Everybody else has taken cover. So he has to go back and say, come on, this is our chance. If we rush in now, The battle is won. So the Roundheads came rushing into the churchyard now. Right. So the only option that the Royalists have got is to head for the church.
Yes.
Now, this is blocked up now, but at the time of the battle, this was the main way into the church. This was the west door.
Right.
And so you have to imagine an absolute frantic rush, absolute bedlam here. Church. And this is where, really, the bloodiest fighting probably took place, with the parliamentarians trying to cut the Royalists off from the door and the Royalists trying to get through here. And the accounts talk about people laying about each other with musket stocks, swords, halberds. So a very, very bloody spot that we're standing in now. Just where we are now,
quite,
you know, absolute
men funneling
hundreds of men, you know, a complete bottleneck of fleeing Royalists attacking parliamentarians through the door that was here, and then they eventually managed to slam it shut. Whether there were Royalists who were stuck outside, had to surrender, we just don't know.
So this is the original door then?
Yeah, this is the old west door
of the
church.
And we saw just now.
Absolutely,
outside.
Yeah. And it's a really remarkable survival from the battle, because when you look, you can actually see the signs of battle in it.
Oh, okay.
You've got, for example, damage where musket balls have struck it. Something has been thrust through the door here that you can see. And here, there's a loophole which the Royalists must have cut.
Yes.
And you can imagine the parliamentarians gathered outside the door, knowing at some stage they're going to have to go through it with a pretty good idea of what's waiting for them on the other side. So it's really, who's going to go first, you know?
Wow, a beautiful church.
It certainly is. Although, of course, on that day in 1643, the scene in here must have been nothing short of hellish.
Yes,
there's smoke everywhere from the muskets and the pistols.
Right.
Dying and wounded men everywhere, blood, even dead horses. One
really?
Of the accounts says that the Royalists took shelter behind dead horses in them. So you had men milling about all over the place in here.
Yes.
Some surrendering, some fighting. You know, but to all intents and purposes, for the Royalists, the it was all over now. But it should be said that the Royalist commander, Colonel Bowles, he was having none of it. And it's said that he took up a position in the church pulpit.
Right.
The pulpit has been moved since then, but the actual pulpit itself survives. You can see it here, a beautiful 1620s affair probably, and it said that he took up his position up in the pulpit because of course from there it was an ideal place to direct operations and harangue his men. It says that that he shouted out from the pulpit, "God damn my soul, if I don't run through with my sword the first man that asks for quarter." The fact remains that he was a pretty determined character, and he died fighting to the last. Traditionally he was struck down in this very pulpit.
The church buildings of the English Civil War and immediately afterwards were very much at the mercy of the new Puritan control, where it's been suggested that greater damage was done by them than Henry's assault on the monasteries. So what of today? Are there ways to raise money to save these churches? I took a trip to Plumpton.
My name is Father Godfrey. I'm the rector of Plumpton and East Chiltington, and I look after three churches in the South Downs. The problems were basically that no work had actually been done on the structures of the churches for 30 to 40 years. It was St. Michael's here that presented us with the real problems. It is an underused church, almost redundant, with a very, very small congregation, very faithful, but it is surrounded by the agricultural college. So, of course, there are very few people who live here. Over the last 150 years, various restorers, in inverted commas, have plastered the walls with cement render, which had meant that the walls cannot breathe. And because we're on gold clay, the place is totally damp. And it was made worse that in 1955, when there was some work being done to the wall, the north walls, that they discovered our frescoes, which date from the early years of the conquest, they're contemporary with the Bayeux tapestry. We had to try and find ways of bringing to people's attention the needs that we had for the maintenance of the buildings. We did all the usual fundraisers, dinner parties, concerts, going to English Heritage Trusts and what have you, which raised most of the money. But to continue to raise awareness, I came up with another idea.
I brew once a month. And it's either a bitter, during the summer it's almost always a golden ale, and I also do a dark old ale. The brewery here is situated right on top of the South Downs. It's about 3 miles from Plumpton Green and about 5 miles from Falmer. I wanted somewhere which was completely away from everywhere.
Yes.
That was hidden away, that wouldn't attract unwanted attention. And most of the equipment came through somebody in the brewing industry who said, Godfrey, I know a field in Kettering where there is so much brewing equipment for sale.
Really?
So we have, it's all stainless steel.
Right.
Beautiful stainless steel. And we have a water heater, water tank we start off with.
Could you just show me that?
Which is here. This is the water tank in which the water is heated up to 72 degrees centigrade. And then it is mixed with the crushed malt in this vessel, which is called the mash tun, to make a mash. What happens in here is that the starch in the malt is converted into sugars, and it's those sugars that are washed out that we boil up with our hops in our boiler over here. It used to be called a copper. When I worked for Shepherd Inn, when I was their excise officer, they had a beautiful copper vessel in which they boiled up their extract with their hops. But mine is called a kettle because it's stainless steel.
There are some who thought it was a wonderful idea and really take it on board. There were others who were very, very against it. My biggest supporters from the brewery come from outside the parish and from other parishes. As far as I know, I am the only incumbent who brews beer professionally.
We have two bitters.
Right.
One which we call All Saints Tipple, which is a 4.5 premium bitter. We also have a 5% strong ale, which was the original one that I brewed, which is called Rector's Revenge.
So, what happens to those churches that cannot find an income stream to save it from closure?
My name's Scott Ralph. I'm an historic buildings consultant and I act on behalf of the Diocese of Chichester with regard to their closed church buildings. It's not very usual for a church building to close, actually. I think it's a general perception that it happens quite often, but actually, I would say probably one or two cases a year in the Diocese of Chichester. If you look at areas where there was a sort of high proportion of Victorian buildings built, so you've got a higher concentration, I think that's probably where you'd find the most closures taking place. Well, Merston St Giles was closed, basically because, I mean, it was a daughter church, it was like a chapel of ease. Just up the road is a small hamlet of Merston, and there would have been farm workers, and when they came to worship, they would simply walked here. And as time's gone by, of course that's changed. Not as many farm workers, and people have got access to public transport and their own cars. So So actually, the need for this building is far less. And there are two other parish churches, North Mundon and Hunston. With regard to what the building could possibly be in the future, that's very open, although it's quite strictly controlled. I mean, this is a Grade 1 listed church, so it's offered the highest protection available to it. And actually, I think a preservation trust or something that would look to make minimal alterations to the building would probably be the sort of thing that would happen. Unlikely to go down a route of residences and the like, just simply because it's not feasible. When the building closes, the diocese steps in and looks after the building in the interim period before a new use is found. So the diocese, is, to be fair, hasn't got a great deal of money to look after these buildings, but we do try to access grant funds wherever possible. Once we sold the building, or leased the building to a third party, then they would ultimately be responsible for repairs. We would offer them as much guidance as we could as part of the disposal process to help them look at how they could access grants, right, or how they could look at doing the repairs, or how they could at least understand what the repair liability is. If we were looking to sell a building for say, residential purposes, then we would effectively market it. We wouldn't accept offers sort of, you know, off the cuff, if you like. But we would look at, the diocese looks at each individual church building and then assesses ultimately what the potential alterations are, what the potential future use is. So, I mean, other uses for rural churches like this one. I mean, I don't know if you've heard of the Churches Conservation Trust. They sometimes take on closed church buildings and they make them available for the general public to visit. So that's one use. I mean, we could look at village shops, post offices, those sort of things. We'd be quite happy to see a closed church in a rural location used for that purpose. Community use, I mean, we're quite happy, if appropriate, to see it used for community use. The diocese believes that it's important that the public have access to closed church buildings as well as open ones. It's not always possible to achieve, but we do attempt to put that in place. And if the building is used for community purposes or it's used as a post office or the like, then there's clearly going to be some aspect of public access. If it is purchased by a private individual, say, uses as an office or the like, you'd be surprised at actually how many people are prepared to allow continued public access.
Churches, as we have seen, have been around for hundreds of years. They're steeped in history and they've played a major part in the social development of their communities. They're always going to face financial hardship as time marches on. But surely it's up to us not to take them for granted and to maintain them for future generations. Till the next time, goodbye.